Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome this morning. Welcome to a very special morning. The title of my message this morning, and I'll call it more of a homily, is Confirming the Faith in Our Hearts. And I got this from our gospel lesson, John 14, 23 to 27. So it is Pentecost, and we celebrate the descension of the Holy Spirit on people and the change that he has done in our lives. And that's a good, right, and salutary thing. But it's not just that. I was looking at John 14, and I said, wow. Jesus says, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Come to him and make our home with him. That's what happened at Pentecost. The Holy Spirit came, took up residence in all those people in that room, and everyone since that has been baptized in the faith that they proclaim, and God has made their home with them. And guess what? You that have been baptized, he's come and made his home with you. Now, I know myself, I'm not a fitting place, temple for the Holy Spirit. I got sin. I got sin every day, and so do you. But Jesus sent that Spirit with the gospel message that proclaims your sin has been forgiven by everything that Jesus Christ did on the cross. You in baptism were washed clean and made a perfect temple for the Holy Spirit to dwell in you forever. When you have one member of the Trinity, you have them all. You receive the Holy Spirit in baptism. The Father is with you and the Son is with you, and he has taken up permanent residence in you forever. Jesus also said, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. So the Holy Spirit doesn't just come to save you and then leave and not do anything. He comes to work in your heart and your mind, to teach you. Teach you what? Teach you what Jesus taught the disciples. To teach you what Scripture says, what St. Paul wrote to the churches, what the Holy Spirit has spoken through all of the prophets and evangelists and Jesus himself. And that is the reason why this is a perfect Sunday to celebrate confirmation. What's been going on in the lives of these confirmands? The Holy Spirit's been teaching them. Teaching them from the Small Catechism what Scripture says, what God says about who we are and how we should live our lives and who Jesus is and what he's done for us. That's what they've been doing. Now, I could sit here and summarize what they did in their whole class, but it would be another boring sermon from the pastor. I don't have enough pillows for you all. So instead, I'm going to let these young ladies speak to you about what they learned. Confirmation. They each picked a verse that they felt represented where they are in life and where they want to be, a verse that means something to them because they are children of the Heavenly Father, baptized precious children. Part of that verse, I hope, will speak to them throughout their entire lives, but it also reflects what they learned in the Small Catechism about who God is and what he has to say to them. And as I read through these essays, he was speaking to me, and he was lifting me up. And I hope as they share with you, he does the same to you this morning.
When I was baptized 2 years ago, the water poured over my forehead. my baptism, God has given me eternal life through Jesus Christ, which is the greatest gift ever. My confirmation verse describes this greatest gift of God perfectly. God has always been perfect in every way. However, when God saw sin had come and ruined his perfect world, he chose to send his only son, Jesus, to die for all of us on the cross, to not only forgive us of our sins, but to also give us eternal life. When God the Father resurrected Jesus, he ascended to the right hand of the Father. My verse gives me confidence that through my faith given to me in my baptism, when God calls me home, my soul will ascend to be with Jesus, and I will live forever with him in eternal life to come. As I was considering which verse fit me best and focused on current aspects of my life, I felt that this verse related to them. On New Year's Day, I got word that someone very close to me in my life, my grandma, had been rushed to the emergency room because she was having a hard time breathing. This had been happening for quite some time. Then things took a turn for the worst. I had been praying about my grandma's health for a while. I was scared because I could hear the fear in my mom's voice and could only sit at home anxiously waiting for updates because the hospital limited visitors due to COVID. But I kept my faith and believed that God would heal her. As my grandma's breathing declined, I panicked and began crying in fear of never being able to hug her or speak to her ever again. It was then that I asked for prayers through social media, and I kneeled at the end of my bed and cried out to God. I was not necessarily asking for a miracle, but focusing more on bringing her peace and comfort, no matter if that was in heaven with my grandpa or at home with us. After speaking with God in prayer, I felt a sense of peace. I gave my worries to God, but I also accepted the fact that this might be my grandma's time to go home and be with God. As the week stretched out of my grandma being in the hospital, as each day went by, she got better and better. Her breathing improved, she could call and talk to me on the phone, and she was sending me funny dog videos on Facebook. That's when I knew my grandma was going to be okay. I'm happy to say I have my funny, smart, and stubborn grandma back. Choosing to leave my grandma's health up to God was one of the best decisions I have ever made. God has truly worked miracles in her life. My grandma Pat is now completely off her oxygen. Her breathing has improved drastically, and she's back to cooking all her yummy meals for everyone in my family to enjoy. I felt this verse spoke to me strongly during this time. I was scared at the beginning, as well as so busy worrying instead of giving it over to God. But then I did give it to God, knowing her sins would be forgiven and she would be given eternal life. This not only gave me comfort, but also gave comfort to my grandma during this time. Therefore, I believe my verse can guide me in my life of faith by reminding me that through my baptism, I have received a huge gift of eternal life, which assures me of a place in heaven. It is truly amazing that there are billions of people in the world, and yet God is able to love each and every one of us and forgive us of all our sins. However, this should encourage me to stop and think before I choose to involve myself in sin. This verse is a good reflection on how I should never take advantage of the gift God gave me when he suffered and died on the cross. Jesus Christ died a very long, painful death, and did so with the greatest love in his heart for me. So I should avoid sin at all costs. I also feel that through my chosen verse, I should encourage others to avoid sin at all costs. Tell others how wonderful it is to receive the forgiveness of sins as the gift from God, and encourage them not to take advantage of this gracious gift. I can also explain what God says is sinful, because some people are blind to certain sins and don't even realize what they're doing is sinning and could prevent them from receiving the gift of eternal life with God. I know that if I live my life guided by this verse, so that I avoid what I know to be sin, while trusting in the gifts I receive from my baptism, I will never have to worry about where I go after I die. At the end of the day, I know I will live with God forever. In my small catechism, I referred to question 3 in the introduction section regarding what is the Christian faith in order to help me understand my chosen verse a little better. Question 3 asks, What has this one God done? It discusses how God has created everything, including our parents. It explains that while everything was created perfect, all human beings have rebelled against God and have fallen into sin. My parents are sinners just like I am and just like you are. This is why God sent his only son, Jesus, to die on the cross and forgive us of all our sins. Absolutely no one is perfect. We are all sinners. Even newborn babies are sinful. The answer to this question goes on to further explain that all people, even babies, are born with original sin passed down from their parents. God knew something needed to be done to save humanity. This moved God, the Father, to send his only son, Jesus, into the world, where he died a brutal death, but then was brought back to life by the Father. God knew the world's only hope to be saved was through Jesus. This really helped me understand what this verse is saying. If you sin and don't believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you will spend eternity in hell. And as previously mentioned, everyone sins. So everyone deserves eternal punishment. But through the faith you are given in your baptism, you will spend eternal life with Jesus in the new heaven and the new earth. This is why eternal life is the greatest gift ever. The Small Catechism also explains the meaning behind this verse through question 98, which states, what ultimately does God threaten against those who hate him and break his commandments? If you break God's commandments, you will deal with earthly punishments. And not only deal with physical death, you will also suffer eternity in hell with the devil. The first part of my verse, Romans 6:23, states, for the wages of sin is death. Living a life where you continue to sin and never repent will prevent you from entering heaven, and instead will give you an eternity of dying. This is why the Holy Spirit calls us to be baptized to receive the gift of eternal life. And it was truly rewarding to be baptized. I ask myself which is better, to enjoy a life filled with sin every day and then experience an eternity of dying with the devil? Or is it better to live a life of obedience to Christ now? Not always doing what I want to do, but knowing I have a spot in eternal life when he calls me home. I hope and pray that everyone would choose a life with Christ. This is why, as a Christian, I believe it's so important to be baptized, so that you can live your life devoted to God. So that you can live your life devoted to God, it's so crucial to know that you have a gift of life after death. The last question that highlights a part of my verse is question 222. In the Small Catechism, which states, why do people die? It says that death is the terrible consequence that comes from sin. God recognized how sinful people were and knew that all people would be forever separated from him in eternal death because people sin, and all people need to be saved through the free gift of faith that baptism offers. To wrap up, Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Each and every person has one of two eternal futures. A long, painful, eternal death in hell because you chose not to have Jesus forgive your sins, or eternal life with God through the gift of your faith given in baptism, where God forgives all of your sins, past, present, and future. That free gift from God, which promises you eternal life with him and in heaven and earth, is truly special and something everyone should cherish. Personally, I am so glad that I was baptized and that I now live a life with Christ, knowing and believing that I have eternal life to come. Thank you.
chose was Romans 12:9 through 10. Let love be genuine, abhor what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with brotherly affection, outdo one another in showing honor. This verse means love must be sincere, that I should hate is what is evil, and cling to what is good. I should be devoted to others by loving them the way Jesus loves me. I should show honor to others more than I do myself. This reflects on my faith because it tells me that God is good and provides me with the best gift in my life, which is eternal life through my baptism. It also tells me that the devil is just pure evil. God loved me so much that when he saw the world was full of evil because of the works of the devil, he knew that the world needed to be saved. So he became one of us in Jesus Christ and died on the cross to forgive us all of our sins, since every one of us are sinful. Through my baptism, all my sins, past, present, and future, have been forgiven. And because they are, he wants me to live a life of loving my neighbor, loving others, and being a devoted Christian. God is telling me that the love I receive from him in my baptism is what moves me to love others. He is telling me that the devil only cares for himself and not about me at all. Because I am Jesus' precious child, I should be loving to everyone around me and never listen to the devil because he just wants me to be sinful. This verse reassures me that through my baptism, I can know for certain and trust God has saved me and promised me that I will go to heaven and have eternal life. I feel that this moment in my life fits my verse best, which is about someone who used to be my friend. We had been friends for almost 5 years. We met in middle school. We had always gotten along and hung out almost every day. Once we got to high school, things started to change, and not for the best. During the start of sophomore year, we started to slowly drift apart. It wasn't for the best reason either. She started talking behind my back and continued to tell others different things about me that weren't true. Later in the year, she started dating someone and completely cut me off. This friendship quickly became toxic. In that moment, I felt as if I really did hate her for the things she did. I know it was not right to hate her, but because of all the things she had put me through, I thought it was the only thing that I could do. We used to go to church events throughout the summer and really connected through those activities. We met some amazing people that had always hung out with and did different things together with them. When she started dating this one person, she stopped attending all of those activities and never came back. In a way, it was disappointing because she had put someone first before God and never chose to go back and ask forgiveness for her sins. During these times, I still continued to go to the church and go to all the activities, but something was telling me to stop going. I think my friend was part of my motivation to continue my journey with God, and when she had stopped going, I lost that motivation. She was the reason I really wanted to advance my journey with God by going to church during the summer. Part of me wishes that we stayed closer, but one day we might find a way to get back together. I think that what happened to our friendship is really reflected in this verse, because you need to be devoted to ones that you love and surround yourself with people that make you the happiest. Whenever we hung out, it was almost as if I had to pretend that I was happy and having a good time. I think that happened to our friendship really showed me how a friendship can go toxic. I clung to her in a way that I thought we would always hang out and never leave each other's sides. I know that God is there for me in every decision I make. God does indeed bring people in your life, and they will sometimes leave for a reason. He knows at the time. I think my friend was meant to be in my life for a good amount of time, but it was her time to leave my life and for us to go our own ways. I think the devil does try and pull us apart into many bad decisions and relationships. When getting into different friendships and relationships, the devil tries to make things happen so that you will end up getting hurt and lose your faith. The main message of my verse is to surround yourself with people you trust and know well and that will care for your well-being. You also need to be genuinely love that person you are getting close with and make it your aim not to end up hurting them. Love is all around the world, but so is hatred. Hatred has a part in our life of all human beings. There is a ton of hate in this world when it comes to relationship opinions on different topics and even the little things. Many of us spend so much time using hatred against others when we should all be doing is loving one another. Every time we use hate, it is a sin. Each one of us sins a ton a day, and we don't even realize it. Hatred, in my eyes, is one of the most powerful sins. It is a part of so many things that have happened every day. As Lutherans, we should be looking for the good in people and looking for how we can make the situation better. We should be looking at Jesus' gift of love, given to each of us makes our life better. We should be sharing that faith and that love and to love one another. One question from the Small Catechism asked what was the main difference between genuine love and pretend acting love. I thought this was a question we should all ask ourselves. Do we truly love someone, or are we just pretending we do it to make the other person feel good? Many people show the pretend love are sinning throughout the whole time. God wants us to be genuine people on this earth that he puts us on, but many of us don't follow that. Another important question from the Catechism was, what does it mean to honor someone? I think the word honor has a lot to do with one's self-respect and how they treat others around them. Many people are honorable in many different situations, but many also don't honor others. You should show honor to all adults in your lives, to strangers, and to yourself. We also should not be really hard on ourselves, but be happy and rejoice that God moves us to be kind and do good things to people around us. The verse I had chosen has a lot to do with the love we show one another as members of his church. Many of us are super close to one another, and that is good. It's what Jesus wants us to be, brothers and sisters in Christ. But when someone new comes in, we should always welcome them as you would want to be welcomed. When we show love to someone that really needs it, that's being the church, that's living out our faith. Many people suffer with different illnesses, and sometimes they just need that one push towards God. Encouraging people to come to your church is another way to help others and to show love to others. It's the way that they can hear about God, who loves them so much he became one of us and gave life to us. Loving others around you by sharing your faith in Christ is the best type of genuine love there is. Faith is the big part of my verse, directing me not to hate others, but instead love them. Faith at my work in my life and yours will take us to the right places in life and show us new opportunities. God is planning your future right now, and he plans to lead you in your life to a good place. God only wants what's best for you and all the way to eternal life. I have learned that sinning can happen in any shape and at any time. But I know that even if you have sinned in the past or even the present, God will always forgive you for your sins if you believe in Jesus and our Lord and Savior, that he died on the cross for your sins and that he rose again so that you can have eternal life. He wants us to grow in the faith in each every day. Sins happen in my life every day, but I know when I confess my sins and believe God forgives me, I can learn to live a more faithful life. Knowing that God loves me and keeps forgiving me helps me keep a positive outlook on life and helps me draw closer in my relationship with God. Those who struggle with mental health issues sometimes struggle with having a relationship with God. I was in this position for a long time, and I couldn't see why it was important to have a relationship with God. It was hard in my life when I wasn't caring about how much I impacted others and how I was treating other people. Many others around you may have not realized that you are suffering and are in need of help or just someone to talk to. When I was in this position, I was hoping that my one friend would notice that I have recently been struggling with things, and I just needed someone to talk to. Once again, she wasn't there for me when I needed her the most. This kept up for about a month before I finally decided to end the friendship. I knew that this friendship was not helpful, but was ruining my mental health. Showing love towards one another and your best friends is something that is very important to do. Looking back, I wish I had faith in God at this time to help me through this hard time. I never tried praying for things to get better. I was just hoping it would over time. Then I finally turned back to Jesus in faith. I surrounded myself with different people and started finding the happiness I was longing for. I learned that coming into faith in Jesus is sometimes a process that can take some time. But the Holy Spirit working through my baptism and the gospel message about Jesus wasn't about to give up. He made sure in the end that I turned back to my Lord Jesus Christ and was trusting in him. I think once I started getting involved in different activities, I learned that you need to surround yourself with people that genuinely love you and Jesus' love, which makes you love the time you're having instead of pretending that you're having a good time. My verse is a big reflection on me and how much I've grown throughout the years and my relationship with God. I hope to continue my relationship with God and continue to grow in faith in the years to come.
I chose the verse Philippians 4:6-7 for my confirmation verse, and it says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ. What this means to me is that when I am troubled about something, I should go to God with it, pray for guidance, and pray for what is needed, and then trust by faith that he will provide what I need according to his will. This may not be what I want, but is what I will always need. This affirms me that I do not need to worry about anything because it is in God's hands. Even though I know that everything is in God's hands, I will still worry because that is in my sinful nature as a person. Because I am a person who believes in Jesus Christ, and because he died on the cross for my sins, I know that I am saved from the devil and will live eternally in heaven. The statement, "Do not be anxious about anything," says to me that God has everything under control in my life. This is important to me to present my request to God because he desires to have a relationship with me. He wants me to draw close to him in body, mind, and spirit. This teaches me that prayer is essential in my life of faith. God knows what is in our hearts and minds. We pray asking him for what he already knows we want and need, because when we do, we confess that he alone is God who can answer our prayers. Prayer is an act of worship. Psalm 50:15 is a good verse that helps explain this. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me. Calling upon God will give me both a sense of peace and a sense of mindfulness, meaning an awareness of my need, an acceptance that he will answer and do so in a way that is best for me. He grants me peace in both my heart and mind with these prayerful conversations with him. The part of my confirmation verse that says, which transcends all understanding, means to me that the peace he gives will go beyond my ability to understand or accept on my own. The peace being talked about here does not come from what you see going on around.
The Holy Spirit is in power here.
Continue on, young lady, have that.
Okay. What's going on around you could be anything but peaceful. But God, through His Spirit, plants His peace into our hearts and minds. It comes from our faith that God is bigger than whatever trouble we are facing that is causing us to be worried or upset. It would be impossible for me to understand, but because I have the Bible, which is God's word to me, I received this peace from him. God had people write the Bible to educate me and future generations about how I should live and about the life of Jesus lived for me. God is telling me what I need to know, and although it may not be all that I would like to know, he tells me the things that are important. This verse speaks to my faith in Jesus Christ because it says I should believe in him to provide me with the things I truly need. It shows Jesus took care of my greatest need by his death on the cross for me and rising again from the grave. Jesus knew and followed his Father's will from the minute he was born and stayed on the path of righteousness by obeying the Father perfectly. He lived the perfect life and never sinned to save a sinner like you and me. Jesus is in my heart and mind, and he will do everything to protect me and make sure that his Holy Spirit stays in me. He will guard my mind and make sure the devil's influence stays out, even though I do sometimes listen to him. It is not because Jesus wasn't there. It is because I simply let him have access to my thoughts, words, and actions. But God, the Holy Spirit, will banish him from my mind and heart. Through faith, I am saved. I plan on staying close to God by going to church, praying regularly, and reading the Bible. I have been baptized into this faith, and it has been affirmed in this confirmation class. Jesus chose me in baptism. He continues to choose me as his word, as he works in my heart and life through his word and the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. What I have chosen to do is work with the Holy Spirit through confirmation class to be confirmed in that faith I was baptized into. Confirmed means to become established and rooted in that faith and grow in the faith, which is a lifelong process. An important part of this growth is seeing, confessing the sins God shows me in his law and repenting of them, turning away from them and turning to God in obedience and love. Jesus' baptism is God declaring that all are welcome in his kingdom, no matter who they are or what age they are. His desire is that all people might believe in him, because if they don't, on the last day of judgment, they will not join him in heaven's paradise. I am God's precious child. Because he cares for me just like he cares for all his children, he loves me and wants me to live with him in his kingdom now and forever. This verse illustrates this by showing that God is watching over me and giving me opportunities that only he can give me. Jesus gave me something to be thankful about, even though I don't deserve it. The gift of his life for my salvation. God sent Jesus to earth to die for me and for everyone's sins because he loves us so much. God hears my cries for help and keeps his promise that all who believe will be saved. Jesus gave his life upon the cross so that every single person could be saved, but some choose not to believe in him and ignore his gift of faith. This verse can guide me in life by showing me how sacred my life is and how sacred the lives of all those around me who have been given his gift of life. My life is so important to him that he was willing to suffer and die for me. God the Father will protect me against the devil no matter what, because he loves me and cares for me just as much as he loves and cares for his son, Jesus Christ. He sent Jesus to redeem every single human being by shedding his blood. When we pray, Jesus is also listening, always listening, and he hears every single one of those prayers spoken by those who believe. We have no assurance that God will hear and respond to the prayers of unbelievers. He may not, but we can be 100% certain he hears the prayers of all who believe in him. God will always be in my life, leading me by the Holy Spirit he gave to me in baptism. In conclusion, this shows that God is leading us and that he loves us enough to send his Son to save all of us who have sinned. He sent the Holy Spirit into us and breathed eternal life into us. Through confirmation, I am reaffirming the faith he gave me in baptism, and I am willing to put my trust in him alone.
Good morning. The verse I chose for my confirmation is Revelation 2:10b. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. This verse is exceptionally meaning to me because it is my mom's, my grandma's, and my great-grandpa Bob's confirmation verse as well. To me and my faith life, this verse means that when I die, my soul will go to heaven and life eternal with Jesus will be mine on the last day. I know this verse means the same thing to my great-grandpa Bob, and I know that he is now in heaven with Jesus. I know that the verse means the same to my mom and grandma too. Jesus lived a perfect life, but I am a sinner. When I was baptized on April 13, 2008, I was reborn into God's faith, and the sinfulness was washed away. My baptism gave me the gift of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit provided God's gift on faith, and he continues to be at work to build it up. The Holy Spirit will continue to build up my faith until I die. And I get to meet Jesus and see him face to face in eternal life. That is why I will be faithful in my life until then. Because through my baptism, I am heir to immortal life. Jesus lived a perfect, blameless life and died on the cross so that each one of my sins would be totally forgotten in the water of baptism. I died and was reborn. Jesus took care of my greatest needs, which is a Savior who gave me eternal life as his free gift. Jesus knew me and loved me before I was even born. Jesus loved all of those who have been baptized into his family this much. I too am a precious child of God through baptism and the Lord's Supper. through baptism, I will welcome into the God's family, and through the Lord's Supper, I am continuing with communing with all the saints past, present, and future in God's family, who are the brothers and sisters in Christ. Martin Luther said, Christ, body, and blood are in with the under and bread and wine of Holy Spirit and is present to continue to build up my faith so I can continue to be a faithful sister in Christ and sacrament of Holy Communion and give me continued forgiveness of my many, many sins. As the Small Catechism states in the response to question 36-2, what is the benefits promised in the sacrament? The forgiveness of sins which Christ won when he suffered in his body on the cross and shed his blood to redeem us is now promised in his body and blood. Give to us to eat and drink. I need the sacrament because I need Jesus' body and blood to continually strengthen my faith so I can stay the course of eternal life with him that is to come. Have a good day.
Verse I chose for confirmation was Romans 1:16-17. I'm not ashamed of the good news. It is God's power to save everyone who believes, Jews first and Greeks as well. God's approval is revealed in this good news. This approval begins and ends with the faith, as Scripture says, the person who has God's approval will live by faith. You really have to think about what a few words really mean, like faith and righteousness, and maybe even what the good news is, in order to understand this verse. When you look up a definition of them, you get things like faith means complete trust or confidence in someone, and righteousness means to have God's approval or to be in the right standing with him. That means you have to know who he is and what he expects from us. Then you have the good news and the gospel of the New Testament. This is the good news of our salvation through Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for our sins and rising from the dead. It is only through what Jesus has done for me in the gospel that I can ever be in the right standing with God and have his approval. This verse reflects my faith in Jesus Christ because I'm not ashamed of the good news or of the Lord and what he does. I trust the Lord. One example of how I trusted the Lord is when my mom had cancer. With lots of prayer done in faith, God answered me, and she was cured of cancer after 13 months of treatment. When I put my trust and faith in God, I realized he had a plan and he was caring for her. Jesus lived every day preaching and telling others about the good news. God the Father told his son, Jesus Christ, his plan to save all mankind. And Jesus, his loving obedience, did what he asked. He always did what was right in the eyes of the Father. Jesus lived out of the gospel in his life, death, and resurrection. And this is the gospel, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God's sacrificial death on the cross in the place of all sinful beings, in the power of forgiving all the sins of his mankind, including me. God came back to life on the third day, and this proves that he is not just making things up. He is the powerful God, Son of God, and his resurrection had to show that his sacrifice can save all who believe in him.
The Holy Spirit says, continue on, young lady.
My sins were forgiven through my baptism, and it brought me closer to him in faith. My baptism has brought me closer by freeing my sins from me and allowing my relationship with God to strengthen through all the good and bad times. God's word has saved me through his grace and mercy. I am forgiven of my sins through my baptism. The free gift of grace from God is his undeserved kindness. He has given me a clean slate for my sins through his only Son, Jesus Christ. This does not mean I can go and murder someone and expect forgiveness and eternal life from God. I need to show him same kindness and love to others and be a good person by following God's commandments. And when I fail, I know I will. I believe that I am forgiven because of Jesus. Because of my faith in God, I will always have his approval, and I will always be his precious child. I believe that anyone can be his child if they have faith in God. As it says in Deuteronomy 4:2, you are people who are holy to the Lord of your God. Out of all people who live on earth, the Lord chose you to be his own special possession. I am precious to God, just like a child is precious to their parents. You are a treasure and truly loved by God. God will protect and take care of his people if they have faith in him and believe in him. This verse means that I have complete trust and confidence in God with my life and soul. This verse also means that I am proud to be one of his precious children, and faith is the free gift that is given to everyone who believes in God. So anyone who can be one of his precious children, that means I should try to be a good person and follow the Ten Commandments in God's word. When I don't follow the commandments or his word, I can ask for forgiveness and receive it. And because my faith in Jesus, I will go into heaven. One of the many ways that my faith can help guide me in my life is I can put my life in God's hands and trust him. In my life lived out in faith, I continue to discover who I am in Christ. God's approval does not come from tests or trials in life to prove that I am worthy. It comes from how Christ overcame in his life with very same troubles that I face. Jesus won the approval for me. He teaches me how to overcome them a little better each day. I will be a true believer that constantly lives by God and his word. I want to keep my faith in God and know that he will take care of me in my time of need. I have God's approval To have God's approval means he accepts me as his precious child and brings me closer to him. I believe that anyone can be his precious child if they have faith in God. Now I understand what it really means to have God's approval. It means that I understand what he does for me, that I listen, that he listens to my prayers, but he doesn't always answer my prayers the way I want him to. Instead, he answers the way that's best for me. No matter what I do, I am still one of his precious children. Now I understand that it means to have what it means to have complete confidence in the Lord. It means that his words guide me. I believe he will always have my back. We have faith in God and trust him as we know that he has a plan for each and every one of us. We may sometimes think that we can't take on any more stress or horrible events in our life, but God only allows us to handle with him as he is walking with us and sometimes carrying and supporting us. We have to keep our faith through these rough patches and know that he is always watching over us every step of the way according to his plan of our life, for our life.
All right, pastor's confession time. When I looked at confirmation program, and like I said, this is the first one I ever did, I looked at it as another thing. It's another thing that pastor has to do. But it wasn't. It wasn't a job. It was an amazing gift for me as well as for you, for them. To watch them and be with them as they grew in their faith, to hear the questions that they asked in confirmation class and help them answer, and also, it wasn't up to me to be there every single day. The Lord blessed me with Katie Grimm, who has a skill set that I don't have. She was their confirmation teacher every Sunday, and she did an amazing job. And I thank God for her. Reading through these essays was not a chore. It moved me. Your faith and your understanding amazed me. Your talk about sin convicted me. And your faith in Jesus Christ lifted me up. And I pray it did that for you here as well as you were listening. Now normally, and I'm almost done here, I talk to the congregation at large. But confirmands, I want to talk with you. Don't see this as an end. It's a beginning. You now become confirmed members of the faith and members of Lamb of God. The Lord planted you here to do work. To come here and praise and worship with us, and when we see you praising and worshiping with us, it lifts us up in faith, but also to use those gifts that he's given you as you used them today. To share your faith with us, and to take that wherever you may go in this world and share that faith with those around you who desperately need to hear what you have to say. This has been an awesome confirmation program, and you guys being my first class, you'll have a special place in my heart forever. Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to serve. Thank you for blessing me with your presence. I can't wait to see what the Lord has for you in the years to come. Amen. This would normally be the time in the worship service when we would pass the offering plate. Those of you that don't normally worship with us, we don't do that. Don't worry about pulling out your checks. Those of us who are members, we know to drop our offering off.